Ranked.no, which is a league and tournament system for any sports like table tennis or squash or shuffleboard, and the Output Company, which is a publishing platform for digital magazines like targeting iOS, web, and Kindle, and eventually Android as well. But today's talk is about Convos. It's an HTML5 async Node.js-like application in Perl, according to the synopsis. So what does that really mean? What is async? What HTML features? And like Node whole, why are we here? Why are Firetrax red? And those are some of the talk questions I hope to cover in the talk, but others must remain a mystery. So often when I tell people that I made an RSC client, they're going like, Merck, really? Didn't that die in the 90s? And yes, Merck mostly died, I guess. You don't often hear ASHX location anymore on IRC. But the Internet Relay Network, that chat, still thrives. And I kind of like this quote that I saw on Twitter. IRC is a chat network for people who run the Internet, by Chris Blizzard. And as you might probably know, IRC is very popular in open source. Most open source projects that I use have their own IRC channel. IRCfreenode.org is full of them, and in the Perl community we even have our own network, IRCperl.org. And Wikipedia also uses IRC to coordinate their efforts. They have bots that announce when changes are made, and the Wikipedians are watching that and screening the changes. So thanks to Screen and IRC2 and later IRC, I was online on IRC pretty much 24/7 from 1993 to 2010. But a few things started to bother me about this solution in later years. I couldn't get any desktop notifications, so if I didn't have the terminal window open, I didn't see what was going on. And I didn't really have good mobile clients. Of course, I have SSH for my tablets and phones and stuff, but it's not a really practical solution, which is why we decided to develop this application. So I got together with Jan Henning Thorsen and started to make Convos. Actually, we called it Virk for first, but we renamed it later to not make it too similar to Mirk. But before I delve into the technology behind it, I want to go through the product itself. So it's open source, and you can find it on GitHub at norwalker/convos. It's artistic license, like Perl itself, and you can go there and follow the installation instructions. It's quite easy. We have a one-line installation script, which you can just download and run to get it started. And it pretty much only depends on having Perl and a big working build environment and Redis. So I'm not going to go through the installation any further, but once you have it up and running, this is the first screen you see. It's pretty standard sign up. If you already have registered a user, the first screen on your installation will be the login screen instead. And once you fill out and successfully register, you meet this wizard which asks you which NIC you want to use and which IRC network you want to use as well. We have some predefined networks in the setup, and you can also list which channels you want to join. You can also use join later to add channels, but this is just the initial setup. However, if you're like using a work IRC or something, some network that we do not support, you can also add the custom network. You just specify the name and the RC server you want to connect to, the default channels to list for, and it will be added to that wizard for next time for next user to connect as well. We do support SSL, but that requires an optional Perl dependency because it requires libssl. So if you run Convos version, it will show you if you have that dependency installed or not. And once you connect to a network, it starts up like this. Here you can see the first conversation in the list on the top hand here is always the Convos bot, which is a built-in conversation bot that you can use to add and join servers. And eventually we plan to grow that into a lot more features. I'll come back to that later. For now, you can, for instance, ask /help to get the list of what you need to do and things like that. So once it finishes connecting to the server, you can see here now it's connecting to Convos, and once you connect, it will switch over to our channel. So you can see here I'm connected. It will always sort this top list by the last visited channels. Where you see it says I'm only joined the Convos now. If you have more channels than there is room for, it will put a drop down on the end so that you can see all your conversations. But it's very convenient because you are in many channels and you just switch back and forth between the last couple. We also have key bindings that let you, if you press Shift Enter, you can toggle between the input field and the channel list so that you can easily just tab to the channel you want without using the mouse. We also have an avatar support. As you see here, the Convos bot always looks like Jan Henning at the moment. But if we are able, if you specify an avatar, you will turn up like I am in the list here. And anyone we can't resolve, we will also try to resolve it based on hostname and look it up in Gravatars. But if you can't resolve it, it will automatically generate a unique avatar for you so that you can recognize the people you're talking to through the same avatar all the time based on their host mask. You're always connected even if you close the browser. So if you go back, you will get a list of the things that have notifications or mentions that you had while you were gone. And if you can also scroll back, we're automatically loading more chat as you scroll upwards so that you can always see all your history. We're using WebSockets to do the communication, so it's really quite fast as well and feels a bit native. As you can see here, we're using CSS media queries so that we adapt to various screen sizes. It works even on smartphones and tablets. If the screen is too narrow to fit the user list, it will automatically turn into a drop-down on the top, so you can find the users by accessing the drop-down in the same way. Here you can see I have more channels and conversations that there's room for in the list, so it adds this drop-down at the end there, so you can see all your conversations. We also support HTML desktop notifications, IRC, and we open source that separately from Convos. It's mojo.com/IRC. We built it up. I found a couple of useful modules on CPOL called IRC Utils and Parse IRC. So basically, we stitched those together with the Mojo IO loop to create something like this. So you have you create a new instance of the object and then specify the nick and the user and the server, maybe password if you use password. And then you can set it up to listen to events. So if you get a join event, you can trigger a message. We have this core connection that's using this module, and it triggers all of the different. For instance, if someone sends a message, it triggers the message event and both stores that into the Redis database and creates a push notification to the publish subscribe. Yeah. The last module that we've open sourced based on building Convos is Mojolicious Plugin Asset Pack. And this is basically an asset pipeline that we use. It's not like a new idea, but it's a good one that you see in many other frameworks as well. Like most Ruby frameworks are using, and Node.js frameworks are using asset pipelines. So basically, you just define the assets that you use in your application. And from the start, we implemented all of the pre-RFC versions of the specification. We were the first Perl framework to have full WebSocket support. We even now support per message deflate, which was added to Chrome now in version 22, so that you can have compressed messages going over a socket. And this is how it looks in the malicious controller. This is a WebSocket connection to /messages. So your JavaScript framework connects to Slash messages, and then we can and then the browser keeps that connection open, and we just receive messages and send them back to the core system from the WebSocket, and we subscribe to Redis messages and send those over to WebSocket, so that we have a connection from the independently running core all the way to the browser. In fact, the core doesn't have to run in the same instance as the front end, so you can easily scale it up if you have many users and set up several front ends that, that run against the same core. Of course, with all these callbacks and small Redis operations, we do run into the problem of non-blocking order dependencies. Sometimes you need to have something running after another callback, or you need to run a couple of operations in parallel and then run another operation. I think in some node samples you might have seen what is being referred to as callback nesting hell, where you have like a callback inside a callback inside a callback. Or even how do you do parallel processes. So the way we have solved this is with a built-in module in Mojolicious called Mojo EOLoop Delay, which lets you specify in a seemingly sequential order how you run your things. I brought up the example here from the synopsis, which just shows that you can a simple example where it creates a delay for 10 different actions. You can see here it sets up 10 timers, and even though this is created in a for loop, they are all added to the same. They will be running in the same order. So this will say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and then. No, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, and then boom. And you can see you can put in a hook so that when all your actions are finished, you can do a callback. So typically, in a controller action, you put this, use the Mojo delay to do all your Redis operations, and then in your own finish hook, you do render. So you run the template in, or generate HTML or JSON or whatever your action is. It's a little bit simpler, more realistic example of how we use it, where I do two Redis operations in parallel, and then output the results when they're both finished. Yeah. So in addition to using building this thing on the Mojolicious framework, we also stole quite a bit of the Mojo culture. So that means we do all our development on GitHub and accept changes through pull requests. We have a common Perl tidyrc, which we actually borrowed from the Mojolicious project as well. So that means we are now, since version 0.4, we are now running Perl tidy automatically on all commits, so that the code base is coherent and we follow the same standard for every commit. So, and we've also been focusing a lot on having a solid test suite based on the same kind of principles that the Mojolicious test suite uses. We use test concon mode Mojo to test all of our controller actions and things like that. So, deploying this thing. My previous open source application, it was Mojo, a wiki based on the Catalyst framework. And it was a little bit of a pain to install. It had a dependency chain of 417 CPAN modules and landed me on the CPAN Heavy 100 top list. So that made it a little bit hard to install. If something breaks in that chain of 417 modules, you have a problem. So Canvas has 9 dependencies, including Mojolicious, and we also use Carton to bundle all of those dependencies with the distribution. So when you download the distribution, you actually know which version you're going to install, so the authors can't just ship a new version and break my application. And Miyagawa made this thing based on his experiences with Ruby. Carton is very similar to a Ruby project called Bundler, where you bundle all the devs into the distro, and then when on setup time, it installs it into the local directory on your application, on your server. So even if you have other versions installed in the system Perl, it will use the local versions when you run that app. He also created the CPAN file format, which is an easy way for applications to specify the dependencies. You know, CPAN modules use makefile.pl using module install or xtutils makemaker, but those aren't really well suited for applications. So CPAN file is supported by CPANM and Carton, and it allows you to specify your dependencies in a really simple file format, and you can also lock the versions to say my application requires this version of the module at all times. So once we have that set up unbundled, you used Carton exec to run your server with the given Carton dependencies. So typically to start Convos, you do Carton exec Convos backend, for instance, or Convos server. So if you run the server, by default it will run the backend embedded, but if you want, you can also run it separately. So that you can upgrade, for instance, the front end or restart front end without disconnecting it from IRC. In addition, we have created a Docker file to make it easy to test this thing, and we have a Docker trusted build. So whenever we do a release, Docker automatically rebuilds the Docker file and updates the code. And that means I don't know if you've looked at Docker, but it's a very simple standard container format, so that you can run different applications with very little overhead inside their own separate Linux environment. So you can, if you have Docker installed, you can just pull and run, and it will start up Convos automatically without any further hassle. It's also possible to deploy Convos to Heroku. That the WebSocket support is in beta, so you have to enable that. But Malicious confirms to the PSGI spec that the Plaque uses, so you can use Miyagawa's build pack to deploy to Heroku. And that was deployment. So I'm going to move on to talking about building the web front end. So of course everything is HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. And we start the first implementation. We started with a quite heavy JS MVC, where we rendered all the templates client side and transferred it, sent JSON over the WebSocket. And we ended up thinking that the solution was too complicated, so we just tore it out. And we're now simplified by generating all the server templates on the server side, and we're sending HTML over the wire. Even the IRC messages are just simple HTML markup that we can push directly into the user interface. Rather than AJAX, we're using AYA. We're also using HTML5 push state so that when you change the channels, we will actually update URLs. This degrades gracefully, so if you have an old browser that doesn't support it, it will just do a full page reload and you will have exactly the same URL. But this also means that we have good bookmarkable URLs. I don't know if you remember, but for a while there was this trend of having hash marks in your URL, which is really annoying because it breaks things and you can't do curl to get the source or whatever, and you will see different things. Pushstate is a much better solution, and it's supported in all modern browsers. The way we implemented it was using jQuery PJAX, which was a jQuery module made by GitHub. They use it for their source tree navigator, where you, when you go up and down in the source tree, it also automatically looks like it's updating the URLs, but it's actually just doing AJAX and JavaScript to change it. So here's how we set that up. For each of the different links, we specify which target that it should render it and which fragment it should use. And then we have a PJAX success trigger at the end, which sets up everything based on the new information that we loaded into the divs. We also started doing the design bootstrap. It's a really easy and fast way to prototype something. And you can make, it's great for making stuff like admin interfaces, but our experience was that if you want to make a really custom specific UI, Bootstrap is more hassle than it's worth. So in the end, we tore it out and wrote a simple custom media query based layout. And it was less work than trying to force Bootstrap to do exactly the things that we wanted. Bootstrap is great for the first 90%, but like you can struggle a lot with the last 10. So in the end, we decided to try to keep it simple, stupid for all of our front-end things. But we still met some problems. The first problem that we faced with the solution was IRC stops working when I move around. Whenever you close your laptop and go to somewhere else, the WebSocket closed and it never reconnected once it was broken. So we used VS Reconnecting, which is a simple module that you can find on GitHub, and whenever your WebSocket connection is broken, it will try to reconnect. And that solved that for us, but then still, IRC stopped working anyways, which was really puzzling for us for a long time. You had it open in your browser and eventually it would disconnect or time out. And we were using the WebSocket ping frame, so we were expecting the keep alive to be working. But apparently, Chrome doesn't really use those ping frames. So we ended up having to create a different solution. This is something we found other people were doing as well. And we're just sending pings over standard WebSocket frames rather than using the specific WebSocket ping frames. And that solved the problem and made it keep the connection alive. Because it stopped working and Chrome didn't even notice. It thought it was connected until you tried sending a message, but you weren't getting any new messages in. Yeah, of course, we also met Unicode problems. I think I meet those in every product, but IRC has no real standard charter encoding. Many people use UTF-8, but some use Latin 1 or other fucked up Latin things. Christian Jansen has made this module called Unicode UTF-8. It supports a fallback to Latin 1 if the parses isn't valid Unicode. So that means that we always send you Unicode out, but if someone sends Latin 1 to us, we can parse it and handle it just as if it was Unicode. So the next problem we met was... We've changed how we use our schemaless storage. How do we update all the existing users? So we wrote Canvas Upgrader, which runs a bunch of migrations in order just to change your database. So we keep track of which version of the application you are using, and whenever you're upgrading, we automatically can transform your Redis schema using the run operation. So this is an example from one of the latest versions where we removed obsolete keys that were not in use anymore, and those will automatically be regenerated. So it's just cleaning up like that. So things that we plan to implement that we haven't gotten around to yet. We do plan to as of 0.4 we have had about 1.5 years of development, and we have a minimum viable product. So we've been iterating until we got it right. But we want to implement search. We already do logging to file, so all your conversations will be logged to the server, but we plan to implement a pluggable indexer backend. We will probably just ship with ACK and the Lester's search module, grep module, and allow you to use Elasticsearch or Zapier or whatever by writing a different indexer. We also want native mobile clients. Luckily, IRC Cloud has open sourced their iOS and Android clients, so the current plan is to implement their API, and then we will get the clients for free rather than having to implement Android and iOS clients ourselves. And the other thing we are looking into doing is plugins. We would really want our RC bot to get more of a personality. So the way we plan to do that is expose hooks so that you can make the built-in bot answer different things. One of the first things I'm looking at is doing an Elisa bot so that you can chat to it if you're lonely. But maybe more useful things like GitHub notifications and things as well. Actually, Canvas can run already without an RC server. So you can just use a loopback connection if you have a work channel and you're only communicating through the Canvas. But we hope to allow enough hooks so that people can customize things for their own use. And the last thing I have on my roadmap is distributed IRC avatars. So that we try to generate those avatars based on the host mask, but that is often not practical. People are IRC from hosts that are not their email address. So we're looking into using CTCP to query clients to ask them for a Gravatar email, and then use that to generate avatar. And we have some progress on that already. There is an experimental branch. So that will probably land in 0.5. And of course, if you want a feature, we would very much appreciate pull requests. This code is open source and it's free to hack on. Of course, it would be nice if you come and talk to us first so that you don't waste your time with re-implementing something that we do. Yeah, so that's I've left a little bit time. How much time do I have left?
10 minutes.
So I have a little bit time for questions, I guess.
I have one. It looks really, really good. Would it make any sense to extend the support to include the Jabber as well as IOC?
Yeah, that would be very possible because we have a connection class which is separate, and it would be easy to subclass that and to use the NetJabber or whatever instead of the RC thing that we do. Of course, you would need an asynchronous Jabber driver, but I don't think that would be a huge thing. I'm not using Jabber, so I'm not hugely motivated myself, but I think it would make sense to do it as well.
Are there any particular issues with particular browsers being supported?
Well, we don't support all browsers. We support all of the evergreen browsers like Chrome and the recent and IE10 and Safari and new Mozilla versions. But like IE6, there's just no way. You have to have WebSockets and so yeah, all modern browsers are supported, but most old browsers will not work.
Including Android WebKit, I suppose.
Yeah, one of the screenshots I pasted was from my Android tablet. So recent Chromes and Android work fine. I haven't tested it much on the 2.0 series, but Android 4 should be perfect. I also have gotten a Firefox phone from Salve in the back room, so we do the plan on testing and making sure that it works properly on that as well.
So. I can report that it works on the Jolla phone with the Sailfish OS.
Yeah, so browser support is pretty good. Yes?
You say that you are keeping the connection even you disconnect from the browser and you get all the log back and everything.
Yeah.
How are you doing that part?
Well, so the core class is sending both push notifications and all the messages to the Redis store, and so we store all of your if you don't have any listeners to the push notification, it just doesn't go anywhere. Or it just doesn't go anywhere. But when you connect your browser, you just fetch the connection list from Redis and get all the messages.
Okay, so you keep the connection live on the server.
Connection lives on the server. Yeah, we're using the IO loop keeps all of the connections that are live in the same thread. Mm-hmm. So if you're running a server with many connections, I really recommend using the EV server. Otherwise, I was doing a test server, and with the pure Perl version, I started getting CPU issues around 15-20 clients that were all using many channels. But with the EV, it scales really well. Over there?
Is there any plan to be able to use it as a bouncer?
Well, you mean like to connect a native or normal client?
Yeah.
Yeah, I did. I have been looking into that, and there is a plan for it, but it is not on the short-term roadmap. Maybe one or two versions from now. Yes.
Have you considered using Apache Cordova for your mobile front end? Because since it's an HTML application, and that's the hybrid frameworks that can give you all the native clients for free.
Yeah, I have been looking into using either that or PhoneGap. The only reason I want it is to make it easier to be able to put it in App Store, so that you don't have, because probably people have a little bit of problem using that bookmark thing to add it on there to their home screen.
Yeah.
And I really want the native push notifications, which I can't do pure Perl. So either Cordova or I'm a little bit confused by those. Because PhoneGap using something else is just also open source, right?
Well, PhoneGap was open source. Completely open sourced, and it was turned into an Apache project, which is Cordova.
So that is the same project. All right.
Can I configure the client to fetch my users from an LDAP server?
You could do that. Right now, it's just stored in Redis, and I don't have any support for that. But I think it would be really easy to implement as well, because authentication is really separate. And since we're using Malicious, I know there's already authentication and libraries for emulation. So right now it's not supported, but quite easy to implement. All right, was that last one? So if you have any further questions, you can come to irc.perl.org at the Convos channel. So connect, you can go get Convos at convos.bi. We actually registered a Belarusian domain because it seemed like a good idea at the time. Yeah, okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the talk. You said something about an Android and iOS application. What were the names?
No, what I said with the IRC Cloud, it's a similar service source, which is not open source, and it's hosted, so you pay per month for anything. They have open source their clients, so if you look at IRC, you can look at and search for IRC Cloud, you can find their clients there. So what we plan to do is just fork them and implement the same API that they do.
I wasn't supposed to be here. I was supposed to be Paul.
Hi. Right now we are using virtual machine.
Okay.
So
it might. Okay, I see. Okay. It might be me. One second.
Okay.